Welcome to Module 16 of Points of Topology course. Today we will discuss once again about interiors, derived sets and so on, just like whatever we have done for closures, etc. last time. Start with the topological space X. A and B be any subsets. Then the following three statements are true about the derived set. A contained inside B implies LA is contained inside LB. The derived set of A is contained inside the derived set of B. The derived set of the union is the union of the derived sets. The derived set of the intersection is the intersect contained in the intersection of the derived sets. L of A intersection B is contained in LA intersection LB. Proofs are all straightforward, more or less similar to the corresponding statements for the closures. So I will leave the proofs to you to write down as an easy exercise. There is one more remark. Just like in the case of closures, if you take infinite union, then only containment will be there. Equality, this number 2, will be replaced by containment. The derived set of a infinite union of AIs is contained in the union of the derived sets of AIs. Okay, so that can also be done. So now let us go to another important auxiliary result about, of course, this again interiors and closures and so on, but this time it is about the so-called nowhere dense sets. Later on, this we will use in proving some major theorem about metric spaces. Right now, this is in a general topological space. This theorem gives you 5 equivalent definitions of when is the meaning of that a set is nowhere dense. The first statement I have included as 0 here. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, so there are 5 statements here. Start with a subset A. X minus A bar is dense in X. Of course, A bar being closed always, X minus A bar is open, that part is easy. So the first statement here is X minus A bar is dense in X. The second statement is interior of A bar is empty. This was a statement for A being nowhere dense. The closure of A should have interior empty. Third statement is A bar does not contain any non-empty open set in X. The fourth one, which is third here anyway, each non-empty open set X as a non-empty open subset disjoint from A bar. A bar A is given. Okay, so these all statements about A bar or A. Each non-empty open set in X contains a non-empty open set disjoint from A. So all these things are equivalent, but we shall prove it in a systematic way, in a economic way, by proving 0 implies 1, implies 2, implies 3, implies 4, and then 4 implies 0. Okay, so that is the plan. So 0 implies 1. zero statement is what? X minus A bar is open and dense in X. Okay, that is the first zero statement. Look at interior of A bar. Okay, interior of any set is an open set. So interior of A bar is an open set and it is contained in A bar. Therefore, it is disjoint from X minus A bar itself. But then X minus A bar will not intersect that open subset. Okay. That means it will not be dense unless that open subset itself is empty. So since X minus A bar is given to be dense, it follows that interior of A bar, which is disjoint from X minus A bar, must be empty. So interior of A bar itself is empty. Okay. Now assume the statement 1, let us put 2. Okay, so every open subset of A bar is a subset of interior of A bar, right? So interior of A bar is definitely non-empty. Interior of A bar, the first statement we have proved that statement one, interior of A bar is empty. A bar does not contain any non-empty open subset in X, is what we have to show. If it is a non-empty open subset, it will be inside interior of A bar, but it is empty. So that proves 2. Okay, 2 implies 3. Similar, if G is a non-empty open set in X, look at G1 equal to G intersection X minus A bar. This is an open set, it's an open set, this will be another open set. It is an open subset of G. Since G is not contained inside A bar, nothing is contained inside A bar, open subsets are empty, right? So G1 must be non-empty, because if it is contained inside A bar, then this would have been empty. Non-empty means there is something here. Okay, so G1 is non-empty. Now 3 follows because G1 intersection A is contained inside G1 intersection A bar. Okay, G1 intersection A, whatever it is contained G1 intersection A bar. So that implies then the fourth statement here, 3 implies 4. Fourth statement is each non-empty open subset of X contains a non-empty open subset disjoint from A. And something is disjoint from A bar and disjoint from A also. Okay. Finally, assuming this statement, I want to show that X minus A bar is open and dense in X prime. Open part is obvious. I would show that X minus A bar is dense in X. That means take any open subset, it must intersect X minus A bar. Okay. Something intersects X minus A bar if it is not contained in A bar. Okay, take any open subset, each non-empty open set X contains a non-empty, there is another non-empty open subset that disjoint from A, so that portion will not be contained in that A, so it will not be contained in that A bar either. Okay, so these terminologies are just, you know, tautological one, but what is the point of doing this one? Suppose you want to deal with a nowhere dense set, then at a particular place you may be using this property, any one of them you can use, and sometimes using this much is easier, whereas using this one will be easier at some place and so on. So this is this fourth one, which looks somewhat tedious one. Okay, this is what is going to be applied when soon we are going to use it in proving Bayes category theorem. So we come to the theorem in metric spaces now. Let X be a metric space. A subset A of X is nowhere dense in X if and only if each non-empty open set in X contains the closure of an open disk disjoint from A. Now, because we are working in a metric space now, we can talk about disks and disclosures and so on. Okay. Just now, what we saw is if A is nowhere dense set, every non-empty open set contains another non-empty open set, which is disjoint from A. Every non-empty open set in a metric space contains a closed ball of some positive radius. Any ball of positive radius, okay, it is the closure of the open ball, right? So that's what we get now. So start with a non-empty open set, okay, which is disjoint from A. Inside that open set, take a ball, okay, such that even the closure is also contained inside that. That you can do, because once you start with an open set, open ball, inside that you can take smaller and smaller closure balls. Okay, so this comes very easily, but this is what we are going to use later on. So I repeat this one. By statement 4 of the previous proposition, if G is a non-empty open set in X, it contains a non-empty open set G1 disjoint from A. Choose an X in G1 and R positive such that BR of X is contained inside G1. Then BR by 2 of X is contained in BR of X. Not only that, its closure is also contained in BR of X. And this BR of X does not intersect. Okay. So you just remember that interior of A bar being empty, the definition of nowhere dense set. Because of the above theorem, any one of the five conditions can be taken to play the role of the same thing. This is what I have already remarked. Okay. Now coming to the metric spaces, we have a few remarks to do about sequences. Okay, start with a metric space. Okay, take a subset X. Okay, take any point. This X will be inside the closure of A if and only if you can find a sequence xn of points inside A such that the sequence converges to X. Okay. The second statement is the point is in the derived set of A, a limit point, if and only if there exists sequence xn of distinct points in A such that xn converges to X. Okay. The difference between these two is that in the first part, you can take some constant sequence also xn, 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 converging to x. So xn itself is x. So that is not allowed here. If x, 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 x is a sequence that is always converges to x, that doesn't mean that x is inside LA. It may be just inside A, that's all. Okay, so LA is a cluster points have a special property. So there is this one, there must be distinct, now sequence of distinct points such that the sequence converges to X. Okay. So let us see the proof of this one. Start with a point in the closure. One way out. Okay. For each N in inside N, we know that if you take B1 by N X, the ball, open ball of radius 1 by N, intersection A must be non-empty because X is in the closure. Therefore, we can pick up a point Xn inside this sequence, inside this Bn intersection A. So this will be a sequence in A, but the distance between Xn and X becomes smaller and smaller, 1 by N, right? As N tends to infinity, this will converge to 0, so Xn converges to X. Okay, the converse that if there is a sequence converging to X and the sequence is in A, then It is inside A bar. This we have seen several times. Now the second part, suppose X is in the, it's a cluster point, it's a limit point. We know that BR of X minus X intersection A is non-empty for all R positive. Start with R, no, R equal to R, not equal to 1. Choose X1 in BR not of X, not equal to minus X, not equal to X. Take a point X1, not equal to X, but inside A. Okay. Look at the distance R1, namely distance between X1 and X divided by 2. R1 is the distance divided by 2. Inductively, having chosen Xn in Brn minus 1 X minus X intersection A, as soon as you choose Xn, look at this number Rn equal to dXn X by 2. Okay, use this Rn to choose the next Xn plus 1 and so on. Okay, once you choose X, now X1 is like this. X2 will be chosen inside BR1 X minus X. So the distance between Xn plus 1 and X, okay, goes on, you know, each time the distance is less than. See, R1 is something, whatever, R is something, R0. R1 is distance will be, is less than R0 by 2. Next will be, it will be R1, R2 will be R1 by 2 and so on. So Rn will be less than R0 divided by 2 over n. So that will come down to 0. Okay. Why this decision? Because look at this one, X1 is somewhere, but X2 will be inside, okay, inside this distance. So distance between X and X1 is R1. Distance between X and X2 will be R1 by 2 or smaller. Therefore, they can't be equal. So next one, which we'll choose, its distance between X and Xn is smaller than all the earlier distances. So they, this is a disjoint, you know, this is a distinct sequence of distinct points. That's why, okay. Okay, so you can write down the contours of this one also. It's very easy. Anyway, so let's go to some functions between, you know, metric spaces, algebraical spaces, first of all, and put them in the proper perspective now. Start with f from x tau to y tau prime, such a function, okay? Then f is continuous, it's one statement. The second statement is, for every subset B of Y, which is closed in Y, the inverse, F inverse of B is closed in X. Remember, what was the definition of continuity? For every open subset U of Y, F inverse of U is open. That was the statement for continuity of this one, that is A. So B is open, sets are replaced by closed sets. The third one is even much better. For every subset A of X, F of the closure of A is contained in the closure of FA. So this is a forward statement. A and B were backward. From starting from subsets of Y, you get something about concluding subsets of X. Here it is the other way around. Okay. D is also similar, but in the reverse way. For every subset B of Y, F inverse of the interior of B is contained in the interior of F inverse of B. Okay? These are all equivalent, just means that you can use any one of them, any three of them or something, to verify continuity of a function from any topological space to another topological space. Okay, that is the statement. So let us look at the proof of this one, which is not all that difficult. First, let us prove A and B are equivalent. This is just by De Morgan law. If U is an open subset, X minus U is a closed set. X minus U inverse image is nothing but, okay, sorry, this is inside Y number I am talking about. Y minus V, F inverse of Y minus V, same thing as X minus F inverse of V. So closed subsets become closed subsets. So you just use one way, A implies B implies A, because you know, complement of a closed set is open subset, and F inverse behaves very nicely under complement. Now let's prove B implies C. Okay, take granted for B, and now let's prove C. C is what? Start with any subset A. Okay, so what you have to prove? F of the closure is contained in the closure of FA. Okay. A is always contained in F inverse of FA. Okay. And FA is contained in closure of FA. Therefore, F inverse of that is contained in F inverse of the closure of FA. Okay. Now, closure of any set is closed. The condition B says F inverse of that is closed. Therefore, A is contained in this closure, contained in this closed set. Therefore, A bar is contained inside this set. Okay, because closure of A is the smallest closed subset containing the set given A. So, this is a larger closed subset. Closure of A is the smallest closed subset containing A. So it was, this one is contained here. But this is same thing as if you put F here, F of closure of A is contained in the closure of F. C implies B is what I am saying. Other way around now. Okay. So start with any closed subset of Y. By C, we have F of closure of F inverse of B, we don't know what it is, okay. Closure of F inverse of B, F of that is by definition contained inside by condition C, closure of F inverse of B, which is nothing but contained in B, so it is contained closure of B. This one is contained closure of B. Okay. Now B is closed, therefore this is B. Closure of B. So F of the closure of F inverse is contained inside B. Okay, this means that this closure of FB is contained in F inverse of B. Okay, but then equality holds, okay, because F inverse of B is smaller than the closure, so they are equal. But then equality holds, okay. And hence, F inverse of B itself is closed because this is a closure of that. Okay. The proof of the last statement is almost similar again. Something like De Morgan law you have to prove. So I will leave that as an assignment to you. Namely, F inverse of interior of B is contained in interior of FB. Okay, you should not take more than two lines. You would write down. Okay, so here are some exercises. A equal to 1 by n, n to n, 0. Take this subset 1, 1 by 2, 1 by 3, 1 by 4, etc. Then include 0 also. Under the usual topology of compute A bar, interior of A, boundary of A, and L of A. Okay, so this is an easy exercise. Similarly, there are some more exercises here which you can take. Now, There is also this Kuratowski's closure axioms, formula 4 axioms for interior operator, obtain a topology associated to it, and prove that the operator coincides the usual operation of taking the interior, similar to Kuratowski's closure axioms. Okay, so let us stop here today. Next time, we will study more examples. Thank you.